our last paper of this panel this morning before lunch is by a group of three scholars.
Two.
We're missing one. I'm sorry to hear that. So in that case, I'd like to introduce Brendan Kane and Elizabeth Kading. Brendan Kane is an associate professor of history and assistant director of public humanities at the University of Connecticut. He's a graduate of NUI Galway and Princeton University and concentrates on early modern Irish and Irish-English comparative history. Currently, he helps to direct an international collaborative digital humanities project, LAVE, Learn Early Modern Irish. Elizabeth Kading is a graduate of the University of Connecticut, where she currently works as a continuing education counselor. She is also employed at Mystic Seaport Museum's Interpretation Department as a member of the Historical Demonstration Squad. She has studied the Irish language independently and at the University of Connecticut for several years, and recently completed an Irish language immersion program in County Waterford, Ireland. Please join me in welcoming them.
Thanks so much, everyone. This is truly, in the annals of NAMPA, something completely different. This is not a research presentation, which of course is the norm here at the colloquium, but rather is a public humanities presentation combined with a sort of coming out party. So the way this is going to work, we'll have basically three pieces. Liz is actually going to lead us out, talking about the story behind the manuscript as she knows it. Then I'll tell a little bit from my side of things and show some pictures, and then we'll actually leave the last word, and we'll come back to Liz for that, the last word to the manuscript's owner, Ms. Katie Hill, who unfortunately was unable to be with us. She's actually undergoing eye surgery at the moment, so keep Katie in your thoughts. And with that, I turn the podium over to Liz.
Thank you. I'm here to tell you the story of how Brendan Kane and I came to be here at the Harvard Celtic Colloquium together today to present William Henley's book to you. This is a story full of serendipitous moments and interactions between a group of individuals from diverse backgrounds who are linked together by their common interest in history and the Irish language. So I'm going to begin 75 years after William Henley inscribed his book in 1825. My paternal grandmother was born in 1900 in Castletown, Roche County, Cork. She was the oldest of eight children in her family and left school after the eighth grade to work in her family's pub and grocery store post office. In her few years of formal schooling, she learned to say a few things in Irish. So she learned Constatatu and Mashtahal and Eishtavail, which are, of course, how are you and please and Shabbat and listen. And these expressions, I'm not sure she learned that last one at school. But she did pass these three expressions along to my father, who was born in New York City, where my grandmother had emigrated in 1927, and there she met and married my Dublin-born grandfather. When I was a teenager in the 1970s, my grandmother taught me her cupla focal of Irish, her few words of Irish, one day while we were sitting at the kitchen table. I was fascinated. I wrote the words out on a piece of paper as best I could, and I practiced saying them. Konasatatu, Moshtaho, Eishtavail. I had no idea how these words should really look. I didn't know how they should be spelled, of course, but I had preserved my grandmother's pronunciation in my rough phonetic rendering of them. In those long ago days before Google and Amazon and YouTube, there was very little a curious teenager living in a tiny town in southeastern Connecticut could do to learn something as strange as the Irish language. And my local library, which is minuscule, certainly did not hold any Celtic language resources in its holdings. Through the years, however, through growing up, getting married, moving, and raising my own three children, I kept that phonetic rendering I had done of my grandmother's words on an index card, and I had it hanging on the refrigerator. And sometimes it got buried by the kids' artwork, but it was always there. And I have to give credit to my younger self for recognizing what a gift those words from my grandmother were, and for treasuring them as I did over many years, moves, and changes. My interest in the Irish language was further piqued on my first trip to Ireland in 2005, when my husband and I had dinner one evening in a pub in County Kerry, and the TV was tuned to an Irish language station, and the men in the bar were conversing in Irish. And I recall from that night that the lemon tart was divine, but just as memorably, I recall how entranced I was by my first exposure to native Irish conversation. But the dilemma remained in 2005. How do you learn more if you're living, in a small town? At that time, this still seemed daunting, if not impossible. About a year after that trip to Ireland, I began work in the Historical Interpretation Department at Mystic Seaport Museum, and there I was befriended by the blacksmith, Mr. Craig Hill. Craig's an amateur historian, and his main interest is the Revolutionary War, and he's a collector of 18th century documents. Over lunchroom conversations, Craig and I discovered that we shared a deep interest in history in general, but especially Irish history and culture. Craig told me that he and his wife, Katie, had taken lessons in Irish language some years before we met, which amazed me. But Katie clearly was better at it, because with my three words of my expressions and his limited Irish, we were not able to put together a coherent conversation. But Craig and Katie had been role players at Sturbridge Village. They worked there together before Craig went to the Mystic Seaport, and they portrayed Irish immigrants. And Katie is the author of a one-woman play about the famine and Irish immigration, which she's performed numerous times over the years, and she's actually published it as a novel. In 2007, I enrolled as a non-matriculating student in a graduate course in 19th century American social history at the University of Connecticut. And as the semester began, Craig Hill one day came in to Mystic Seaport and he handed me a tiny, ancient book. This was William Healy's book. And he gave it to me with the suggestion that perhaps I might be able to write a paper about it for class, and he hoped that I could translate it so that he'd know what it meant. This was, he told me that he and Katie had been given the book by a family friend named Jim Bump, who had worked with Craig Katie at Old Sturbridge Village, and Jim had picked it up in an antique shop. And he passed it along to them because he suspected, but he wasn't sure, that it was written in Irish. And he knew that they had studied Irish a little bit, and he hoped that they could make something of it. I remember sitting there with Craig Hill, looking through the book. We went through it page by page, and we just were puzzled over it, and we marveled at it, and we wondered if that strange language that was written in was really Irish or not. We, at that time, neither of us knew enough to read or understand the Irish in William Hilly's book. But we both knew enough about history to recognize that the book surely had historical value, and that it was unquestionably something rare and very interesting. I took the book home with me, I showed it to my family, and then I stored it in a little cabinet I have, and I never did write that paper about it. So there I was, with my grandmother's Cupola Foco preserved on an index card on my refrigerator, and William Hilly's book resting in my cabinet, and no premonition that either object would ever have any more meaning than that. Then in 2008, my younger brother was given Rosetta Stone Level 1 Irish Learning Language Software as a birthday present. And my brother, Matt, is a skilled genealogist, and he's our family's historian. And he has a very deep interest in Irish history, particularly the events of 1916. Matt, yet another amateur historian in this story, was intimidated by the prospect of learning Irish, but he was determined to give it a try, so he asked me to join him and try learning it with him. It turns out that this was the opportunity I've been waiting for since the day my grandmother first taught me to say those few words she recalled from her childhood in County Cork. Matt and I were enthusiastic from the start, but I well remember the evening that my Rosetta Stone lesson included how to say, "How are you?" in Irish. And there on the screen, I saw and heard the words, "Conasitatu." And I ran to the kitchen, grabbed that faded index card off the refrigerator, and I sat there in amazement that it all come together. I compared the two renderings that I had, and it was just a remarkable moment of delight and recognition and validation. And I sensed at that moment that I discovered something I hadn't even really been aware was missing from my life, and that was the Irish language. So as enthusiastic people sometimes do, I'm afraid I became a bit of a pain in the neck to my friends and family and coworkers from then on, as I persistently tried out my Irish on them. And my brother soon met his future wife and had other things on his mind, so I found myself with really no one to converse with Astralga. But another Mystic Seaport colleague, a carver and a passionate language learner named Phil Marshall, heard that I was learning Irish, and he told me about a group who belonged to UConn who met once a week to converse in Irish. Phil assured me I'd be welcome to join. I hesitated because I was still very unsure about my limited grasp of the language, but Phil persisted, and I finally made my way to Storrs to join the group, and it was there that I met Brendan Kane, who was our mentor. As a self-taught student of the language, I was intimidated, but at the same time, I couldn't believe that after all these years, I'd landed in a place where others shared my interest and enthusiasm for the Irish language. For several years, I made that weekly drive to stores to meet Brendan and other language learners. I have to confess that William Healy's little book kind of slipped my mind during this time. But one day, I was dusting, and I came upon it in my little cabinet, and I paged through it. And at this point, there was no more uncertainty. By then, I knew enough to see that the pages in the book were indeed written in Irish. And I thought, Brendan might find it interesting. So one day, for show and tell, I brought the book up to stores with me, and to say that Brendan was interested is quite an understatement. So that's how William Healy's book finally went from an object of curiosity dwelling in obscurity into the light of day at the Harvard Celtic Colloquium. And although we may never know how this little book landed in an antique shop where it caught the eye of a craftsman from a living history museum, it's thanks to a group of people with a shared interest in history, particularly Irish history and the Irish language, that is now preserved and we're able to present it to you today. Gold Margaret.
Yeah, so one thing I should clarify is H. DeVale was never something said in our class. That was picked up at home. So now I'm going to tell you a little bit about sort of my side of the story and that Irish reading group. It's just something that was open to the community, it was open to everyone. People would come in, and we are, as you can imagine, incredibly delighted that people would make the effort to come in and take part in the reading group. And so I guess what I want to say here is part of the reason why we actually did the reading group, I mean, it's really for kind of two reasons. One is because we just thought it was an important aspect of what a university, especially a state university, should provide. And if there were people who were interested in the language, then the very least thing that we could do was to try to share some of what we knew. But secondly, there was also a kind of professional and sort of curricular reason as well, in that we were interested in trying to make Irish a taught course at the university, and one of the ways in which we could do that is try to actually generate interest. And so we are incredibly grateful to Liz and to everyone else for taking part. So what I'm going to do now is show you a couple pictures from it, and I do think the rest of the presentation from my perspective is really about two things. One is about the importance of the humanities, and I really do think of Harvard as one of these great models for this, which is, I mean, when I think of the Department of Celtic Languages and Literatures, it really does do the kind of, you know, high game and low game, so to speak, perfectly, right? I mean, this is the center for really top-end research in Celtic languages, but obviously it's also a department that has a very strong sense of community and reaching out, so we're grateful for that model as well, as we kind of fiddle our way through things up in stores. So, but then the second thing is, this is also a presentation in, or I guess this is a kind of effort at, or a sort of moment for reminding people like myself to stay in your lane, as they say, which is, you know, I'm not an expert of the 19th century, I'm not a paleographic expert, and so you will see, obviously, some of the limits of my paleographic abilities. And we do think it's really important, as Katie the owner thinks it is, for the manuscript to really to be in the hands of the people who do this work in the 19th century, and therefore it's actually not our interest, mine or Liz or Katie's, to take a stab at being the ones to actually introduce the entire text to the world, because we think that really should be something that people who are experts in that period should have the opportunity to do. And I think for two reasons. One, because we'll learn a whole lot more. But then two, I think in keeping with this idea of collaborative work and public humanities, the people who are experts, whether they're graduate students, early career, you know, tenured, so on and so forth, having access to the manuscript might actually be really important for their own professional development. So we will leave it to them. However, we will give everyone a sneak peek. There it is. And Katie, of course, is the owner, so all images are by her permission. And I have to say, when Liz first said, hey, I have a book, can I bring it in? I was like, sure. And she said, yeah, I can't really understand the reading, you know, the writing. I was like, oh, it's kind of Shanflow print. It's probably one of those, you know, kind of mid-20th century translations, you know. So I was like, oh my gosh, it's gonna be in Ungoom version of Wuthering Heights or something. So it'll be a cultural curiosity, but lo and behold, this shows up. And as Liz says, I was a little delighted. And this is, you know, kind of the title page. Let me see, 1825, and I'll just kind of move fairly quickly through these. We can always come back to them if you have any questions. And again, you'll see the limits of my paleographic skills, but this seems to be the first piece on Chagas de Chien on So. I mean, it seems to be, you know, a kind of macron over the ends, and so I've doubled the ends, but nevertheless, there it is. I don't know what the text refers to, so if anybody knows, we'd be delighted to learn. And then this, I mean, after each piece that he completes, he provides a signature, and so you can see there below, William Healy of White Rock, and so he's from White Rock, which is Middleton in County Cork. Now, obviously, it's a beautiful, beautiful hand. And then this is the piece that takes up most of the text. This is the Astra Shine y Chomel. You know, and again, this is just a sort of question that I have. It's not clear to me why there's a Leonidan C before what I take to be the spelling of Shom. But seemingly there's, as Google tells me, attestation for this. And I'm sure someone here can enlighten us. But this is, of course, Turf Maharan, the 17th century political poem by John McConnell. And what's interesting is that Healy produces it, Irish on one side and English on the other. Now, what I don't know, and obviously don't know is the kind of operative phrase here as we talk about the text, what I don't know is this his translation? Is this something that he copied out? And Ireland's, so there was a translation of the poem entitled Ireland's Dirge that came out kind of in this period. And so it'd be interesting to know if this is a transcription out of the published edition, but I haven't gotten my hands on it, so, but again, I do think it's best to leave to those who actually work on this period, and they can enlighten us all about the provenance of the text. So, but anyway, so that goes on and takes up most of the book. And it is quite interesting, though, because there are some differences, because, as many of you will know, this is a poem that shows up in Cecilia Rapley's 5 17th century political poems. And there are some differences even within the first couple lines. So if we go back very quickly, whereas O'Rahilly's has Dihu Nini, Healy has Bals Arnini. And so again, is that where do those differences come? Where is he getting this from? And one thing I should also point out is that you can see here we have Healy spelled with an A, because everywhere else except on the title page, he writes his name H-E-A-L-Y. And Dihu, perhaps a little bit more serious than Boss. So an interesting bit of perhaps kind of political commentary as well in that. But as you can imagine, and I certainly haven't gone through it, but there are all sorts of variations, little variations as we go through. And one of the interesting things too is that he seems to put R, right, so the plural first person possessive, in where O'Rahilly's edition tends to have on as just a kind of simple genitive relationship. So again, seems to me to be quite interesting. He repeats the title from time to time, just so I thought I might show that again, and here it's abbreviated, right, just Astra Hjörn. So at the end of the poem, see, you can see the signature again, and I think it's, and perhaps this is something that is standard, but he signs it, and I suppose a colophone of some sort, but does this in English, which is interesting, not sure why, but finished by William Healy, July, and it lacks the final prayers that are in the O'Rahilly edition. I mean, it's the Ave Maria and Our Father, Pater Noster, and so his ends with out it, which is interesting. But you can see he ends it on the 10th, about, I can't remember off the top of my head, but about six, seven pages later, the English finishes, and he finishes that about 8 days later. He tells us on the 18th day, and again reminds us that he's there in White Rock. Then he moves on, Shenor Ina Hesta, right? So, you know, the sermon, I guess, Good Friday, and, you know, so that's a piece. It'd be interesting to know, I mean, is this something circulating around? Is this something he heard? I don't know, perhaps he's a member of the clergy himself, I do not know. And I think this is a quite interesting piece, and sorry, this was a picture taken with a different iPhone. So it has a slightly different effect to it, but as you can see, it says finished by William Healy and so on and so forth, 1827. But down below it says, for William Healy's use, the Lord be our guide, amen. Which I think is really quite fascinating. I'm not sure who was the audience for that bit, but nevertheless, as Liz was saying, we had a bit of a, we had a few problems this morning getting everything together, and she's like, yes, that is the curse of he told us right there it was for his own use, and here we are, not listening, going to public. But nevertheless, I thought that was quite fascinating. And I think this is really, this is largely why we refer to it as a commonplace book, right? Trying to figure out what such a thing might be. And this is, I think, in many ways, the kind of star of the book. Is a poem by Park Hong Joon. Oops, sorry, I forgot the fada over the first U, which is up there. But nevertheless, Ask there. And if I find the clicker thing, don't worry about it. Just sort of going in order. What I think is great is this is a page that you can show to, you know, any English speaker, and they can read bits and pieces of it. You know, because it says, you know, the Park Hong Joon. Over Kanduah, Teve, Ray, Kahar, Utica. Right, so in upstate New York, Igundi Oneida, Estas Nilaur, which is tremendous, right? So it gives you some of that information. But then down below, you know, telling you, I suppose, whence he got his copy, and sort of linking the provenance of that to Ballymacota in Cork, in the county of Cork. So Ballymacota, about 40 kilometers down the road from White Rock, so give us a little bit of sense of the manuscript, right, network, very little bit anyway. And then the first verse, and so then it runs through and it has the quatrains, and evidently there are differences within these first two quatrains and other known versions of the poem, so I hear. So again, something for a scholar who works on this stuff to benefit from, and to enlighten us all. And then I think this, to my mind, this is the other sort of superstar bit. And so this kind of, you know, prayer, the Ave Maria on top, and then this thing about sort of Gloria Dio Wicke, right? And what it says is, either will cure them, but the bit of meat is to be hid in a ditch or a dunghill to rot. And then in the name of the Father, as said above. And so as we were, you know, as one does to cure oneself, hide some pork and a dunghill, and no surprise, after subjecting oneself to such a cure, you would indeed say your prayers. But nevertheless, for those who are interested in kind of medicinal cures and things like that, this might be really quite fascinating. And unfortunately, there's a bit cut off at the edge, so. And I think that's it. I will turn the floor back over to Liz to finish up.
One of the consequences of William Healy's curse is that my printer died last night, so I had to read this off my phone. This is Katie Hill's bit, and I also have to tell you that I inadvertently seem to have stepped into some marital drama, which you'll understand after. Provenance of William Healy's book. This is from Katie Hill. William Healy's book was a gift from James Bump of Putnam, Connecticut. Katie said, I had been researching and designing an interpretive program about pre-famine immigration to central Massachusetts for Old Sturbridge Village. Although he cannot recall the exact location, Mr. Bump had purchased the book at either an antique store or a flea market in northeastern Connecticut around 2001. he thought it might be of interest to me in my work. Because it was written in both Irish and English and there were some classical references, I thought it might be a diary written by an immigrant who was either a priest or a school teacher. I could not understand the Irish in the book, and so I put it away in a cedar chest until I could find someone to translate it. When I opened the chest to retrieve it one day, the book was missing. Since my husband Craig and I had moved 2 years earlier, I thought it might have been packed away in an unopened box. Craig said he hadn't seen it for a while. When we were getting divorced, and Craig was moving to Maine, I asked him if he had come across the book when sorting through his belongings, but he told me he didn't see it anywhere. I searched unsuccessfully for the book again when I was preparing to move last winter, and this past spring, Craig called with news and a confession. He had given William Lilly's book to Miss Kading a few years earlier. He had wanted to surprise me with the translation as a Christmas gift at the time. Liz found the 19th century Irish difficult to translate, so she brought the book to Brendan Kane. When Brendan saw it, he recognized it as a rare commonplace book. And Katie says, I agree with Brendan that the contents of William Healy's book should be shared with historians and scholars of Irish.
That was a very delightful paper. Thank you very much. We have some time for some questions and maybe look at some more images.
Yeah, those are the only images that we have, but we can look at them again.
And you might or might not know this, but Padraig O'Mahon from Cork has written at least 2 articles, if you've read them. One is about manuscripts which were brought to the States from Ireland. I mean, you maybe you've read this a little bit. Okay, so in your next episode.
Yeah.
And the other one is about books like this which were compiled in the East Cork, West Waterford area from about 1800 to 1850. And it was quite common to, according to him, to this kind of thing that people usually, often become middle class, strong farmers, and the like.
Right.
Not necessarily school teachers or clergymen got them compiled either by somebody else who would write or themselves did the borrow stuff. And I mean, there was a whole network going on there.
Right.
And they kind of it's a semi formal. But Padraig really knows an awful lot about it, so he might be able to, particularly about that area.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. And I've been talking to Paul sort of back and forth about the book, in part trying to just sort of figure out, help Katie a little bit as she decides what to do with it, right? To sort of get, find it at home. But no, thanks a million. And again, I do think it's important for the people, Paul wrote, and other, to be the ones really to do the scholarly work on it. So again, we just thought we wanted to do the coming out part.
Yeah.
I'm wondering, is this all that there is on the, you're guessing the cure, does it say what's the cure for?
That's as good as we got.
So my guess would be that it may be for warts or something like that, where essentially they will go away through time and the sort of magical act of taking something and rotting whatever it is, the pork flesh, away, basically will cause or parallel the wart actually
right.
Just carrying away.
Right. Wart be gone.